breakfast. And Lord, we just come to you with our prayers, Lord, and we just ask you to answer our prayers, Father. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So I'm a little sick today.
Oh, Pastor, did you talk to him?
Yes, I did. She called.
Did she? I called her and told her not to. She didn't have to know about that. It's wrong, man.
Thank you.
classroom and you, yes, Richard?
Number six.
Oh, okay. We'll play number six right after our prayers. Pastor, will you lead us?
Okay. Trust you had a good week last Wednesday. I wasn't here, but was praying for you. Of course, on the prayer list that you have in front of you, we are praying, of course, for our church. We're praying for Atlas particularly, and then Richie's family. And that includes young Master Mason over here. And then Maria's aunt. Stage 4 lung cancer, correct? Okay. So we're praying for Mary's aunt Maria. She's got stage 4 lung cancer. And so we're asking the Lord just to give some comfort there. And trust that Mary will be able to give her a great testimony. And then Louise, of course, here every week, always in pain and asking that we would continue to pray the Lord for her healing. I talked to Red, that being Joyce to most of you. Talked to her on the phone. Sunday night she called me, and she's getting the antibiotics and everything that she needs. And so she's at home. Both of her her daughter and her son-in-law are RNs, and so they're able to at home give her the intravenous that she needs. And so she's doing well. She just has no strength, and anybody who's been through that knows what that's like. So she would ask that we'd continue to pray that she would recover strength, and that she would soon be with us. Of course, she wanted you to know that she loves you. And then Victoria, you know, our dear sister, she's have kidney problems, and she's asking that we would pray for those. And then we're praying for Uncle Paul for his back and his legs. And then Josie's sister, of course, who is dying of cancer still, we're just asking the Lord might give her comfort. The movie that the boys are working on, that they continue to work on it, and that the Lord would have his hand on it, that it would be a real testimony. Our missionaries, of course, in India, the Philippines, and Mexico, they're working hard. They are seeing great revival, of course, in India, and we'd like to continue to pray for that. Our good friend, Abu Paul, working hard. Love that name. And so we got to be praying for them. Many of the young people, as they have taken a break, have gone out and started new churches, new works, and so they are continually reworking with those. One of the things we have to keep in mind with India is becoming more and more anti-Christian. It used to be that the Indian people were probably the most cordial of folks when you would go there. They may not like you, but they were not mean. But they have begun persecuting Christians in the northern part of India. And they've been doing that now for some years. So we do need to pray for these new converts, that the Lord will keep them safe. And then, of course, you know, the difference between America and many of the other parts of the world is there's no Christian thought pattern. And so the cruelties, and I'm sure you've seen it on the news even concerning, for example, the Middle East, where Christ isn't brought up, they can be extremely, extremely cruel in that part of the world. And so I just remind you of that as we pray for India, the Philippines, and even in Mexico. Of course, all the gang warfare and the different drug lords that are down about there. So keep our missionaries in prayer. And then, of course, we'll remember the persecuted Christians throughout the Middle East, particularly over there, as you've been watching there in Iraq and in other areas. Many of them being murdered off by these ISIS groups. And so we do need to pray, because there, you know, we pray for comfort, usually in this comfort country. They're praying for their lives in other parts of the world. You know, our prayers compared to theirs must seem sometimes rather silly. Things that we pray and ask for when you are facing this kind of torture for Jesus So if you would, anybody else have anything that they want to add to this? All right, Brother Richard.
I haven't been feeling too good in the last couple of days. My balance has been off, my thoughts of my heart, kind of things that's hearing, but I just need a healing. I am.
Okay.
I agree with that.
All right. Anybody else? All right, let's go to the Lord. Father, we thank you so much for our church. We thank you, Father, that this is a place where we can gather and meet with you. Father, we don't need a grand cathedral because you promised as long as there's at least two, you would gather with us. So, Father, tonight, with near 10 of us, we're sure that you've gathered alongside with us. We appreciate that. So, Father, we do pray for our church. We pray, Father, that it may continue to be faithful. Lord, I think of the words that you spoke just as you were about to go back to heaven. One of the things you reminded of your disciples was, when I come, will I even find faith? We pray, Father, that not only you would find faith in us, but you would find us faithful to the end. Father, these are difficult days, and Father, I believe that we are nearing a close, perhaps to the church age, and perhaps Jesus, you know, or Father's kept that from you, I suppose, that soon enough you'd be coming for us. And we look forward to that day, but till then, keep us faithful. We thank you, Father, for Atlas, and we thank you for the good that we have seen in him. We thank you, Father, that we can see that prayer has been working. We see, Father, how attentive he has become, and we appreciate, Father, all that you're doing. We ask, Father, that you continue to watch over him. What a blessing. Sunday morning, he came into my office, just wanted to shake hands with his pastor, and I was glad to have him there. So we pray for Atlas, Father, as he's away from us, that you'd keep him and watch over and keep him protected. Father, as well as young Master Mason here, Lord, we appreciate him too. And Lord, when we pray for Atlas, of course, we pray also for Mason. Lord, that you'd use him in a mighty way. Father, he has a difficult life, I'm sure, ahead, as all of our young people do, as this world gets worse and worse. But Father, keep these two, we pray, close to you. Pray for Richie's family. Father, we thank you for the house that you gave them. Thank you, Father, for the opening toward this work that you give to Richie. Pray, Father, you continue to prosper him. Pray, dear Father, that you give him wisdom, and that, Father, he would always seek your face in all of his decisions. Father, bless him and his family. Keep them safe, keep them strong, provide their financial needs as well. Father, we do pray for Mary. We pray for her burden as she is concerned about her Auntie Maria. Father, stage 4 lung cancer is a difficult, difficult thing for the family to deal with. And so we pray for them. We ask, Father, that somehow you'd speak into their hearts and might Auntie Maria come to know Jesus Christ. Might we have that confidence and that assurance for the trust in Jesus Christ. So I pray for Mary and for Mikey as they work with Maria, Father, to bring her to a sure knowledge of Christ, that she might not be afraid, that she might know what lies ahead of her. So, Father, I pray for them. Give them wisdom. Father, for Louise, I thank you, Father, for her. Thank you for her friendship to this church and to this pastor. And pray, Father, right now for her comfort. And, Father, you continue to touch her as she comes. Father, for Joyce, I thank you, Father, that you have given these doctors such wisdom. And, Lord, you've given her a family that is able to take care of her in this way. So I pray, dear Father, that you just continue to make her stronger and stronger until she returns to us. Father, for Victoria, we pray for her and for her kidney. We ask your Father, you'd strengthen her. We ask your Father, that you'd allow her to come back and be with us more often. But, Father, take away the pain. We just trust, Father, that you would touch that kidney there. She's only got the one. And so, Father, we ask that you would strengthen it and make it better. We thank you, Father, for Uncle Paul. We thank you for his faithfulness. We thank you for the bringing of his grandkids. We appreciate all that. And we ask, dear Father, that you make him stronger, that you touch his back and his legs. And, dear Father, allow him to continue bringing his nieces, or I think it's grandchildren and their little friends to church. We thank you, Father, for Joyce. We thank you, Father, for her faithfulness to her sister. We thank you, Father, that she's been back with us. But we do pray that her sister might find that comfort and that Joyce might find those words to share with her sister during this difficult time. We thank you, Father, for all the work the boys have been doing on this movie. We pray to Father as they continue moving forward, that, Lord, they would be allowed to complete it, and, Father, that we might have the joy of watching it, and, Father, of having it speak to our hearts. And so, Father, we also pray for our missionaries. We think of India, Father, a great revival taking place there. We thank you, Father, for all those boys and girls that we have the responsibility of feeding. We thank you, Father, that you've allowed us to increase our giving. We thank you, Father, for the faithfulness of our people. That, Lord, every year we've doubled, and already we've already doubled what we've given last year to missions. And so I thank you, Father, for our people and for their faithfulness. Ask, Father, you just continue to use this church to reach out to this world. Not only the India, but, Father, the Philippines, which is so close to my own heart. I built my first church there, and I ask, Lord, that you touch our Filipino friends, and, Lord, watch over them, help them to grow. Help them, Father, as they rescue these boys and girls. What a ministry, Father, and I pray that you continue to bless it. And then for John, his dear wife down in Mexico, thank you, Father, for him. Thank you that he has been my friend all these years. And I thank you, Father, that he has stayed faithful to you there in Mexico. And I pray, dear Father, that you continue to bless their outreach. Bless not only the four churches they've already founded, but this fifth one that they're establishing even now. Father, give them much grace, I pray, with the Mexican people down there. And also, Father, we are mindful of our brothers and sisters in the Middle East. Father, who are being tortured even as we speak. Those, Father, who are unable to defend themselves. And, Father, so many that you have given into the hand of the enemies. But, Father, we pray for their faith, that it might continue to be strong. And that, Father, we might be faithful to them as we pray for them. Father, watch over them. And we know, dear Father, that someday their blood will cry out to you, and that someday you will judge this world for its treatment of them. But, Father, today, we're asking that you keep them safe tonight. Watch over them, we pray. Pray for Richard, for his balance. Touch him, dear Father, that he might have that equilibrium that he needs. Bless him now. Bless our church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's turn to page 6, Face to Face.
Rapture.
Father, thank you for this day, Lord. Prepare the pastor and Lord, and prepare our hearts, Father, for as it gives us to your word, Father. We love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Okay, 2 Chronicles chapter 17 is where we are tonight, 2 Chronicles 17. And our text is going to come out of verse 6. We're talking about, let me just give the name here. We're going to be talking a lot about Jehoshaphat, a name that's quite familiar to many of us. He was just a little bit afraid that I would spot it. 2 Chronicles. Now, remember, Chronicles has been written long after. Now, the Jews have been taken into captivity. They were there for 70 years. They have come back to the land, and they're in the process now of rebuilding. They're going to have several reformations. There's going to be the rebuilding of the temple. Then there'll be the rebuilding of their religion. And then there's going to be a rebuilding of their civil responsibilities as well. So Jerusalem becomes the head one more time. But the people have a problem. I mean, we've talked about this. Nehemiah and Ezra were the two major contributors to this information that we've got. There were also some of the other prophets we talked about as we have preached through there, Zechariah being one of the last ones that had spoke to these people. And they were trying to get them back to work. And so the writer of Chronicles went back to the history of Israel and to Judah. And what he keeps saying throughout 2 Chronicles is, listen, under Solomon, remember, we came to Solomon, we had this great, this was the golden age of Israel. As Mikey would say, Israel. To me, it's just Israel. And so the golden age of Israel under Solomon. Solomon was a king, the temple was built, he was fabulously rich, we talked about all that, the whole world was sending him money. It was what we would call the golden age. David and Solomon. Under Solomon, they had peace. It was a great time of peace, a great time of prosperity, and a time to which the Jews look back to. How come we lost that prosperity, they have to ask themselves? Why aren't we like that today? And so the second thing the writer begins to do is he shows the rest of the kings. Some were good, some were bad. When the king was bad, the people and the children of Israel and Judah suffered because of bad kings. And then they would get a reformation under a king, things would come good again. It wouldn't be too long until they would go bad again, and God would have to discipline them. And then they would get another good king, and there would be this spirit of revival, and things would be good to them again, and then things would go bad. Well, right now, as they're writing, they're coming to the story of Asa and Jehoshaphat. Asa, and it doesn't happen too often in Israel where you have two good guys in a row. Almost always when you study the kings, you'll see if it was a good king, he has a bad son. If there was a bad son, there's a good grandson. My grandson, J.D. and Mr. Christian, probably twice as great as their grandfather. And to do much more than I do. That's the general history of it. And so he's dealing with them, showing this, here's how come we're where we are. This is how come we have to rebuild the temple and why it's all just rubble down around our feet. Now, do you want to stay in that position or do you want the blessings that came? So he's using the story here of Asa. And Asa is said that he walked in the ways of his father David. When you study 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, you'll see a phrase that's often used. It will say, they walk in the ways of their father David. Or it will ways of Jeroboam. Now, Jeroboam was wicked. He was the one who established the false religion. David wasn't perfect, and almost always it'll say they walked in the ways of David in the beginning. Because if you look at David's life, the first 11 chapters, he's pretty good. Chapter 11, he sort of falls off. Okay. But then he struggles the rest of his life to rebuild himself. And so here's what we're up against. This is a story that's given to us. And so the emphasis in chapter 17 is found in verse 6. His heart was lifted up in the ways of the Lord. His heart was lifted up in the ways of the Lord. In the Latin, it would read sursum corda. Sursum corda. It means lift up your hearts. And so, of course, sursum corda is a phrase that we should learn. The idea here is to lift up your face like a child does when he's about to be kissed by his father or his mother. You know, you've seen them when mom and dad come home and the kids come up and they lift up their faces and wait for a smooch. My granddaughter, she come running to grandpa and then turn around and hide. Until I bribe her back. She'll usually, I'll be sitting in my chair, she'll come over, she'll lean her face forward. I know she wants to smooch me, I'll smooch her right back. And same thing, JD, he'll walk over to my chair where I'm at, he'll say, hi, Grandpa, and then he'll lean his face in. What are they doing? They're putting their faces out there where Grandpa can smooch them. And so here, this sursa corda means to lift up your face so God can kiss it. That's the whole idea here. And how did he do that? This is used in connection with Jehoshaphat. Asa to some degree, but at the end, when you read Asa, it says, God says, well, you know, he walked in the ways of David, but he had this problem. It reminds me of when we read through the book of Revelation. It says, I love these Ephesian guys, but I got this problem with you. I love this church over here, but I got to tell you, I got a problem with you. And he goes through Laodicea, hey, a crazy bunch of guys, but here's your problem. And the same thing he says to Asa. Asa's a good guy. He walked in the ways of David, but... And God... You know, when I get to heaven and I walk into heaven, God says, here's Terry. Wow, hey, Terry. You know, I loved what you did, but... I hope you don't tell everybody in heaven, you know. Maybe you just whisper it in my ear, whisper it in your ear, right? My thing, though, when I walk into heaven, sursum corda. I want to lift my face to be kissed by my Heavenly Father. Jehoshaphat did that in the fact that he lifted up. There was no mistrust in him. He was surrounded by the enemies of Israel, as Israel was surrounded so many times. But usually what they would do is the king would go off and try to hire Syria as their helper. Or they would go down and bribe the Egyptians to help them out. Not Jehoshaphat. When he had a problem, he went to the Lord. He would get on his knees and pray. He would open his Bible and find from God what answers he had for him. And so then after he would read his Bible, sursum corda. He would look toward heaven. As he prayed, he would look up toward heaven, holding his face up there, knowing that his Heavenly Father was going to kiss him and that things were going to be okay. So, you know, in our depressions, in our, which happened to the king, he gets word, hey, guess what? Bad guys are coming. Okay? The next chapter, you're going to see that coming. The Syrian army is going to march against his countrymen to the north and threaten him as well. Although Israel and Judah don't get along a lot of time, they're going to work together to overcome Syria. Bad king, King Ahab. Same time as we have this good king, Jehoshaphat. When the foes are pressing in, what did he do? He prays. Sursum corda. If we understand, you know, I think Michael had quoted that verse to us just Sunday night. You know, or it could have been Sunday morning when he was preaching. When he said that, you know, God said, I know my thoughts toward you. I know my thoughts. I know what I'm thinking about. And I got to tell you, my thoughts toward you are good. Now, we sometimes think that, wow, God just can't wait to pick on me. with God. See, my kids may not agree with all the discipline they got from me. But I know every time I disciplined them, I was hoping to accomplish some good. I was doing what I believe should have been done at that particular time to help make them into the men that they would eventually become. Now, they may not have always said, search them for them when Dad worked in the house. Sometimes they probably said a few bad things when Dad was gone. But I knew my thoughts toward them were good. I'm not an angry dad. It's not like, oh, I can't wait to get home so I can beat my wife and kids again. You know, those are not my thoughts. My thoughts toward my wife and my kids have been good. I tell folks all the time when they would try to have us work overtime, I would say, listen, you don't understand, I don't go to work to get rid of my family, to get away from my family. I go to work to provide for them. So, you know, I don't want to work and work and work and be an absent father. I want to be home. And so we were very fortunate that we were probably more of a pest to our kids than most parents get a chance to be. Because my wife and I were fortunate enough, as we built the schools that our children attended, they were there with us. And then when they came home with us. So whether they were in school, whether they were in church, whether they were at home, good old dad, good old mom, right? Problem though, we have to consider about this lifting up our hearts. Because sometimes we would rather lift up our voice to God than our heart. And usually when we lift up our voice, it's usually pointing some accusation toward God. We usually are telling God what he's not doing right. My children were never allowed to correct Dad. Couldn't do it. Just, I'm sorry, you don't get to correct me. And the reason for that is, and I would tell my kids, and I say this often, I would say, you know, you don't get to say whether I'm good or bad. You can't say Dad's good or Dad's bad because they will then say God is good. See, you don't even really get to say that God's good. Because if you could declare that God is good, there will be a time when you can declare that God is bad. Or not so good. So we only get to declare that he is God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Because sometimes I gotta say, the things that come into my life don't seem like they're good. God's looking at things from a whole different perspective than we are. You know, most of the time we consider, for example, that death is the enemy, and death, you know, what God, that's the punishment that God uses to get even with us. Truth of the matter is, it's how he brings us home. You know, except for the rapture, the only way you get to heaven is through the gate of death. And yet, we make that the curse of all curses. When in reality, it's, I've saved you from this miserable existence, I'm bringing you up to heaven with me. And so, someday, you know, as we are looking up and the trumpet will sound, we will all search some court of our faces, we'll all be lifted up, and God will be able to switch us on the face. So, in this, we remind ourselves, the Bible, Jesus once said to us, unto thee, O Lord, or rather, we remind ourselves, do I lift up my soul? When we think of Jesus Christ, not only do we lift up our face, but unto him we have to lift up our soul. It's that lifting up. You know, it's one thing, you know, if my kids don't want me to smooch them, they can just keep their head down. Right? They just hang their head. And then they don't work because I'm going to smooch the top of their head. I'd much rather smooch their face. But hey, I'll still smooch the top of their head. Sometimes Mr. Christian, because he's old now, you know, he's a teenager, sophisticated, macho type fellow. And you know, when everybody else has to get a smooch, he'll run for the high country to get away from Grandpa. But I might be old, but I can still run a little bit. And if I can't outrun him, I just have to outthink him. So I'll catch him when he's not expecting it. But if Grandpa still get his smooch, what I can do is I can wait. Because he'll want something sometime. The other day, he wanted something. He came to me and he told me something that he wanted. And I said, Grandpa doesn't do anything for free, son. And as much as he doesn't, he pretends he doesn't like it because he's all grown up and handsome. And you know, he's got a bearded face now and it scratches my lips when I have to smooch him. But hey, I still get a smooch of fun. So there's some poor that still, you know, lift up your face, boy. I'm going to smooch you. And so that's what God says to us here in 2 Chronicles. Now, when you read it, and we just went through it, I want you to look at all the blessings he gave. And when you read chapter 17, he says, I gave this to Jehoshaphat, I gave this to Jehoshaphat, I gave this to Jehoshaphat, I gave this to Jehoshaphat. Why? Because Jehoshaphat loved me. Jehoshaphat worked very hard at being the friend of God that Abraham taught him he should be, that David said you could be. David said, I can be a friend of God. God said, listen, here's my servant David, the man after my own heart. And Jehoshaphat tried hard to become that same thing. And God said, therefore, I've given him this, I've given him this, and I've given him that. Sometimes we complain about the things we don't have, but when's the last time you lifted up your face so God can smooch it? Got to be careful there. Now, with that being said, go with me over to 2 Chronicles chapter 18, because now we're going to introduce both Jehoshaphat again, but I want to bring you another fellow named Ahab. You have to be careful of the company you keep, because your company, the people you hang around with, here's the problem. Whoever you spend the most time with is the person you become the most like. My wife and I spend a tremendous amount of time together. Therefore, my wife and I are very similar. Very similar. Mikey and Mary spend a lot of time. So, of course, Mikey and Mary being very similar. Mary is more like Michael than she is like me. Because she spends more time with Michael. My grandkids are more like their dad than they are like their grandfather. Why? Because they spend more time with him. Whoever you spend the most time with in the course of a day is the person you're going to be most like. So choosing our friends becomes very important. If all of our friends are non-Christian people, guess what happens to us as Christians? We begin to behave in a non-Christian way. It's important, especially in this world, that I spend more time reading my Bible than I do conversing with anybody else. That's why when I get in my car, 45 minutes to work, 45 minutes to an hour home, I'm going from Romans to Jude. Romans to Jude, all week long being played. All the letters of Paul, the letters of Peter and James, Jude, I'm getting all of them several times a week. As I'm coming and as I'm going, about every 2 or 3 days, it restarts all over again, and I repeat the New Testament epistles. Why? Because I want to spend more time with God than I do with anybody else. And so in the course of a week, I'm trying or attempting to have the Word of God in me. So that when I make a decision, I don't make a decision that somebody else would make. I try to make a decision that the Lord would make. When I speak, I don't want to. I'll tell you one of the problems you have, and it happened to me when I was in the Navy. I'm in the Navy, I'm away from, there's no Christian people as far as I know. Everybody is cursing like a sailor. Right? I mean, you get up in the morning, there's some guy cursing in your face when you get up, there's some other guy cursing at you while you're standing in line. Some other guy is cursing at you while you're getting your food. Some other guy is cursing at you to get on out there. And guess, even though I didn't realize it, I wrote a letter home to a friend. And when the friend got the letter, they said, you know, I didn't know you talked like that. What are you talking about? So they sent me back the letter that I had written. And I had no idea that kind of language even, because I wasn't writing it with my mind. But those words were creeping into my own vocabulary. Why? Because that's all, you know, the Bible says you cannot help but speak to speak things that you have seen and heard. Everybody today talks like they live in a gutter, including the women folks. Including women. And they do that because they watch movies and TV that are filled with that kind of stuff. And you sit there and you say, you know, if you limit what you watch, oh, you're crazy. Everybody talks like that. Well, they do now because they're all watching the same stuff. It's easy for, you got to watch my grandkids. If they watch a good movie, boom. Every now and then, a good movie will slip out. So you have to be very careful. If I have to watch a movie, I got this thing called the TV Guardian. I'm trying to slide that thing in there. It takes out all the words. Why? Because I don't want to talk that way. I don't go to our movies because I don't want to talk like that. I was a sailor. I don't want to talk like that. I worked very hard at educating myself so I have words at my disposal. I worked on my vocabulary. When I was in the Navy, I bought myself a dictionary. And I would read the dictionary. I'd learn. I'd just go through it, and I'd apply several words in the course of a day to my list of words, my lexicon of life. And, you know, people say, well, that's kind of weird. What do you got that for? I said, oh, I'm just learning a new word. Well, they had two words, and they used them for everything. Me, I would rather have several thousands of words so that I could express myself without falling back on vulgarity. I had a fellow at work, professes to be a Christian, goes to one of the big, huge churches, right? And he tells everybody he's a Christian. Oh, I don't want to hear this. And then the next thing you know, he's in the exact same time. He gets upset about something, everything is awful. It was really, you know, in fact, the other guys were making fun of him. Because they said, yeah, he walks around saying he's a Christian and uses this kind of language, that kind of language. So I thought I'd better pull him aside and let him know they're talking about that way. He needs to watch that. Because next thing you know, they say, well, you're a Christian too, you probably do the same thing. You know? Only when I get after him. No, see, I you don't want to. You've got to watch those things. I would trust that none of our people in our church would ever use that kind of language. That are, you know, because how bad that sounds. People say, oh, you're good, what church you go to?
Oh, I go to the,
like, in my church right over there. And they have no idea they're talking about. But here's, go down to verse 7. Jehoshaphat, the good guy, the one who is walking after the ways of his father David, who walked that way at the first. Asa, who is bringing about these great reforms in his and great revival in his own country, sides up with a man named Ahab. And they're about to go to war with Syria. And so Jehoshaphat says, listen, do you have a man of God up here in Israel that we can ask, should we go to war or not? Now, we've decided, we're sitting here talking, but before I can commit my armies, I want to know what God says. And Asa said, well, yes, there is a man of God. Micaiah. But I hate him. I hate him because he never prophesies anything good to me. Only evil. I hate him. And Jehoshaphat said, well, he's the man of God. Call him here. Let's find out what he's got to say. In the meantime, they get all the rest of the false preachers, and all the preachers say to King Ahab, oh yeah, go to war. God's going to give you the victory. One guy comes in, and the preacher, and he's got bull horns on his head, and he had them made out of iron, and he said, the Lord told me that you're going to tear through Syria just like a bull, and you're going to just gore them all to death. And I like that idea. Micaiah comes. And they say, and before he gets there, the preachers surround him and say, listen, we've all told the king good news. We want you to tell the king good news too. See, today everybody wants the preacher to say good things. Happy little thoughts. Unfortunately, I don't want to fit into that happy little thought regime. But that's what everybody wants. Well, you know how you're not going to build a big church if you don't say nice things. Well, I say nice things when the Lord's got nice things to say. And I say the truth when the Lord's got the truth to say. And I say bad things when the Lord's got bad things to say. I don't get to write the script. And so Micaiah comes and he speaks to Ahab, and Ahab said, what should we do? And he says, oh, go to war. Go ahead, you win. He said, listen, you know I hate you, but don't I always tell you to tell me the truth? Even if I don't like it, tell me the truth. Micah says, okay. Lord gave me a dream last night. You go to war. And all of a sudden I saw all the children of Israel scattered as sheep without a shepherd. The nation of Israel will be sheep without a shepherd. And he says, see, I told you I hate that guy. He never says anything good to me. And Jehoshaphat says, but he's saying the word of the Lord. Ahab doesn't believe him. Ahab goes to war. He's killed. All the sweet guys told him what he wanted to hear, but it cost him his life. Well, I got 30 guys over here saying good. I got this one lousy guy over here saying bad. 31, I'm going to go with that. Go ahead. My job isn't to say sweet. My job isn't to say nice. My job is to say the truth. So Micaiah told him what the Lord had said. He didn't like it. Ahab loses his life. Why? Because I hate him, he said. I hate him. He never says anything good. We live in a time when people are looking, you know, have what the Bible says refers to them as people having itching ears. They're looking for somebody who's going to say good things to you all the time. You're going to be lifted up. You're going to be embodied. You're going to become noble. The only truth, the only problem with that is when the tough times come, they're not ready for it. And so, you know, really the whole church faces, you know, the Bible tells us just like Ahab. Ahab hated that man who stood for God. Why? Because he said what God told him to say. People will always pick on us for being narrow-minded. You Christians. You think you're the only ones who know the right way. I don't think I know the right way. He told me he was the way, the truth, and the life. I'm not making this stuff up. I'm only quoting what he said. I have decided that he was God, and as God, he is infallible. And he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. What can I do about that? Apparently, my mind is just as narrow as his. And so, when I speak to the world, I can't give them any other option. That's why when I talk to people religiously, I don't try to make them feel good. I try to tell them about Jesus Christ. That's my job. When I leave somebody, like I was telling the guys at work even today, I said to them, listen, my job, and this is my concern, my job is to struggle for your soul. You're going to die someday. And you're going to stand before God. And you're either going to walk into heaven or you're going to walk into hell. Now, I got to tell you, fellas, I am going to heaven. You all know I made that declaration because Jesus Christ died for me. And you know what it's going to do to my heart when I knew I stood right there by you for all these weeks or months or years or however long the Lord gives us. And then you're pushed off into hell. Now, they don't like me talking that way, but it's not my job to be nice. It's my job to win them to Jesus. So what if I said something nice to them and they ran away and smiled? And then in hell opened their eyes being in torment. See, that's why when I talk to people, I don't talk to them about my church. I talk to them about Jesus, and at the close of it, I give them an opportunity to receive him. That's all I'm responsible for. I don't care if they like me or not. I have had a lot of people in this world not like me. used to it. I've traveled halfway around the world and a whole scores of people that don't like me. But there are quite a few that do. Because I was faithful enough to tell them this. Jesus Christ died for your sins. If you trust him as your Savior, you go to heaven. I don't want to say something nice. Well, have a good day. Oh, well, you know what? I go to a wonderful church. I wish you did too. You know? What does it matter? Some days they're standing before Jesus and they look over at me and say, hey, that guy worked with me. We went to the same, we worked together for 3 or 4 years, whatever it might be. My friend Lloyd, who passed away. We worked together for 5, maybe 6 years. Suppose I get to heaven, he says, I worked with that guy for 6 years and he never told me about Jesus. Never gave me a chance to repent of my sins. Never gave me a chance to know that how I can, oh, he always told me have a good day. He was always nice, he was always polite, he was always kind, he was always sweet to me. And he always said good things to me. He always said he'd pray for me. But never once invited me to receive Jesus. And one day he runs into a telephone pole and doesn't survive. First thing he learned from me was Jesus Christ the righteous. Came and rededicated his life. Came and assembled with us here for a short while. So when he passed away, his family called me and said, just wanted to say thank you. Thank you for helping Dad rededicate his life. My job wasn't to make him like me. My job was to make sure when he got to heaven, God could say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And so that's our responsibility as we go from this place. Whoever we meet, when people come into our path, that's your number one concern for them. All those folks you know at the apartment complex, it's not whether or not they're having a good day. It's not whether or not you cheered them up that day. It's whether or not you're going to see them in heaven. Because someday they're going to see you at judgment. And they're either going to say, wow, Ellen never told me. Richard never told me. Nancy never told me. Mary never told me. Kate never told me. Or they will say, wow, I'm glad they told me, because here I am now. That's our responsibility. Jehoshaphat could have been quiet around Ahab. They were both kings, and he could have said, well, you know, he's a king, he's entitled to what he thinks for himself. But no, listen, there is a man of God, we need to hear God's word. Ahab said, I hate that man. Yes, but he's still a man of God, let's listen to him. Now, Ahab never gave his life back to the Lord, died and went to hell. That's one of the worst men in all the Bible. But the best man in all the Bible, at least in our story, didn't let him go without confronting him on it. You can't change, you can't win everybody. You'll win very few people based on the number of people you meet in life. I don't win everybody. Bless God in somebody from time to time. And that's what we do. We mean somebody from time to time. Father, thank you so much for the story of Asa. Thank you, Father, that you blessed him for being your friend. Father, he simply did what you asked him to do. Help us, dear Father, to do the things that you asked us to do. Help us, dear Father, to tell people of Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, not to be ashamed of our Bible. But Father, to be willing to hold it out to the lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, look at that handsome guy. You ready to play us a song?
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, that's Michael's tune. You can't sing Michael's song, he's not here. He'll poke me in the eye. He'll poke me in the eye.
Yeah, did you hear what he did sing? Oh,
that's right.
Thank you.
We're going to play the page seven.
Cheers.